with acclamation.
You may be seated.
Thank you, Dr. Freddie. He has such a wonderful sense of theater, doesn't he? I love it. Please remain standing. No, sitting now. Good morning, family. Just a joy to see you and to welcome you at my own words and to welcome those who listen to us on the World Wide Web and to see so many people. I thought everybody was at Calabash. But those that are there are carrying the light for us and living and loving and holding the truth, and we are here doing the same for them. So united in the truth, we stand proclaiming the truth for this wonderful, wonderful country and, in fact, for every land. Isn't that just a wonderful thought?
Indeed.
My encouragement this morning is titled, Help Wanted, Apply Within. You see, I have a friend who has been looking earnestly for a job. And when people tell me they want a job, the first thing I ask them is, what is your passion? I want you to think about that for a moment. What is your passion? What gives you that fire in your belly bottom, you know, that feeling that I really want to do something in this area or to learn something in this area or to contribute something in this area? When I said it to my friend, he didn't hesitate. He said, working with youth at risk. Wow. I said, I wish I had a couple hundred thousand photocopies of people who want to work with youth. Because, you know, I really believe that if we intend to make this a world that works for everyone, that's where we have to start. We have to start with the youth. My personal passion is perhaps to get to the teachers who work with the youth so that we can begin to establish a new paradigm of love, unconditional, which love has to be or it's not love, and tolerance and openness to all the various, the wide tapestry and the diversity that God has blessed creation with in people of every single hue and color and creed and belief, and it's just such a wonderful world, isn't it? And so I said to my friend, well, that should be easy. You should be able to find a job that, reflects your passion and that to which you can contribute while earning mega bucks, you know. And he said, I don't know. It always seems that before I even open my mouth, when I meet people, they're turned off by me. This is somebody who is educated, you know, he has many degrees, he's intelligent, which is for me even better than being educated. He's personable, he's well-spoken, and people, when I observe him with them, take to him like ducks to water. And yet still he has this mental set that, boy, I don't know, I seem to turn people off. Now we in truth know what he's saying, don't we? If he is applying for jobs and he is filling out he's doing those applications on the net or however, and he's sending them out with a mental set that, I don't know, I turn people off before they even meet me. What has he done? He has signed, sealed, and delivered his fate. And you know, last week, we had 8 teenagers and their youth advisors visiting us from Centers for Spiritual Living in Colorado and in Oregon. They came from both states. And they linked with Jordan Bennett, another young person whose passion is helping others. And they had a most rewarding afternoon at the School of Hope in Augustown. And then they and our Temple teens got to meet some of the young people from the L.C. Beamond Girls' Home who participated in our youth service, at which our Temple teens excelled themselves. Am I right? Who was here last week for the youth service? Let's just give our youth a round of applause. They were wonderful. And during their 3-night stay here in Kingston, our visitors were accommodated by Temple members who also share a passion for working with youth. Lilith Nelson, Sandra Cooper, Carmen Clark, Kelly Tomlin, all opened their hearts and their homes, while Norman and Kim Nahr and their boys, and Tina Sherman and Lana Francis, along with our Sunday school teachers and Temple staff and our practitioners, all pitched in to make their visit a memorable one. And I love what happened here because they experienced the best of what we have to offer. You know, when we Jamaicans entertain, we just do it full out. at all levels in the society, with people who, you know, from our community, but also they have gone to Adelphi in St. James, and they're staying with humble families in their homes and working on rebuilding a school there, on refurbishing a school there. So they have seen every aspect of Jamaica, and I just think that is a wonderful part of their education. And while they were here, they educated us too, you know. They're only different colors, but they're all the same, our teens. Am I right or am I right? Uh-huh. But everybody just pitched in to make their visit such a memorable one. Some of them were here last year, and they've returned. One of them babysat for the year and paid her own way to come. She was the little one that spoke last year, Addison, and she was here again this year. And they've said when they're leaving, God help us. We want to bring more people, Reverend John, Uncle John, next year. How many can you take? I said, not many more. But yes, let them come in their thousands. We want them. Let us give our own people who made their visit so wonderful a round of applause. It's really funny because, you know, we that study this aunt of mine know that what you give your attention to invariably manifests in your life. So it's no surprise that today we're welcoming George Young's Raytown group, which is working on positive behavior for a positive future. And I just want us to applaud the work that George is doing. I have to concentrate to call him George because I know him as Junior. You don't mind. But let's get back to my job hunting friend, whose passion you remember is working with youth. As we chatted on Skype, he said, I've flooded the market with resumes and I've been to so many interviews I've lost count. I don't know what it is about me. Boy, John, my ego is taking a terrible beating and I'm beginning to wonder if I'm worthy of the job I want. Can you imagine that if you get to a point in your life when you begin to wonder if you're really worth it? Now, friends, as I said to you, this is a person who is eminently suited. And so what I did, you know, if I'm dealing with one of my own temple people, you're my family and you know me, I say anything that comes to my mouth. As a housekeeper once said to me when she broke up an item, and she said, it broke, sir. And I said, it broke itself. And she said, yes, sir. I said, but you know it can't break itself, so you know you need to take some responsibility. And she said, well, I'll just give you the most convenient thing that comes to my mouth. We Jamaicans do that sometimes. I think people do it generally, but I know my own people. We give you the most convenient thing. So sometimes if I'm talking to people who are of my own family here at the temple, I can just say anything that comes to my mouth, you know, and they know that's Reverend John. You just take it as you get it. But if it's somebody who doesn't have our kind of background, I'm a little more careful. So I was thinking, how do I get across the message to him that he's really in a self-fulfilling prophecy? Of that is going to just make it impossible for him to succeed. So I was there thinking, and after a long while he said, you're dead, eh? For those who are listening overseas, that means, are you there? And so I said to him, you know, I want to tell you something which may sound a bit amazing to you. But the master teacher, Jesus the Christ, said, it is done unto you as you believe. It really comes to you as you believe it, you know. And I love that term, as you believe, because it means, for me, in the moment that you believe it, as well as it's done unto you according to what your belief is. And so I took the bull by the horns and I said to him, you have a job to do that is bigger than any job for which you have applied. And that job is to deepen your understanding of your union with and importance to life. You are important to life. Can we say that together? I am important to life. And friends, when you understand this, and I was saying to him, when you understand this, the right perfect job allows you to pursue your passion and express your life purpose. It just presents itself when you really believe that you are important to life and that you bring something which nobody else can contribute but you. Finally, there was a silence and I didn't ask him if him dead, eh? Are you there? I just allowed him to think about this. And eventually he breathed a soft, whoa, which is a phrase I use a lot. So I laughed, I said, oh, you take up my word? No, wow. And he said, so what do I do? I said, the universe has out a classified advertisement which reads, help wanted, apply within. And then I gave him one of my favorite affirmations, which is, spirit is my employer and my paymaster. Can we say that? Spirit is my employer and my paymaster. I am uniquely qualified for the business of life. Together, I am uniquely qualified for the business of life. And I suggested that he write out this affirmation, which is one of my favorite assignments too. I'm not giving it to you today though. And that is to write out that affirmation, spirit is my employer and my paymaster. I am uniquely qualified for the business of life, 21 times every day, to write out that statement 21 times every day for 21 days. He said, are you serious? I said, do I look like I am laughing to you? I said, try it, you have nothing to lose since every other application you have sent out has drawn a blank. Well, you know, within days of this conversation, he was offered a consultancy with an international agency to which he had not applied and had not sent out a resume. One of the areas of focus of this agency is, guess, children at risk. Damn, isn't this universe just amazing? Excuse me, bless, isn't this universe amazing? And hear this, his starting salary exceeds what he had hoped for. Because that's how the universe works, friends. If you say, I am ready, the universe says, yes. So friends, the universe wants someone to express what you have to express, what you bring this morning as you sit here within the sound of my voice. It wants someone to express unconditional love. It wants someone to express wisdom and compassion. It wants someone to express abundance and all the good that life is in creative and wonderful ways. And the benefits of this employment are excellent, and the opportunities for advancement are unlimited. But you have to apply within. Many young people in Jamaica tell me, boy, I have 5 subjects, but you can't get any job except you know somebody. What a mental set to have. I said, you don't know nobody. Everybody knows somebody. May I know somebody? May look like somebody to you? And so, you know, I remember Professor Rex Nettleford saying, talking about the somaditization of Jamaica. We have to make ourselves into smaddy so that we don't believe that there is smaddy else who has the say-so over whether we succeed in the business of life. And so, friends, you have to turn within your own consciousness and begin to apply all that you have been learning so far, here at the Temple of Light, in your readings, in your coming to continuing conversations that matter, not CCTV, Reverend Freddie, CCTM, continuing conversations that matter. In our classes, in our Tuesday evening services, we need to begin to apply. This is an applied teaching. It's something that you can take outside of the laboratory of the classroom. What is a lab? What do you do in a lab? You experiment. So when we come to classes, we experiment with new ideas and chew things over in creative ways. And then you have to go out into the real world and apply what it is you have been learning. You know, I never forget one Sunday thinking, yes, I need to exercise more patience. That was kind of the message from Dr. Elmer that Sunday. Making an agreement to be more patient. And as I drove out of the gate here and hit the corner, a man bad drive me. I can't tell you the patience. It was many four-letter words. So I said, wow, you know, you just finished talking about patience and here you have an opportunity to exercise it. And what do? You blow the lesson. So we need to start applying what we say we believe and what we are learning in our spiritual journey. It's time to take stock and to rewrite the curriculum vitae by which we are living our lives. Kathleen Hawkins, a co-author of a book titled Time Management Made Easy, writes, and I quote, long before your first professional job, you were hired for another job, for something greater and more global than 9 to 5. She postulates that our real job description is to, and I want to share this with you, quote, first of all, individualize spirit on this plane of activity. You have to individualize God because there is not another one like you. So who you are and what you are and who you are being and what you are doing is God expressing. Just think about that responsibility. You individualize the creator of all that is. Secondly, you have to enjoy unlimited love, prosperity, and abundance. And that doesn't mean that you have to be a multi-billionaire. It means that we have to learn to enjoy what we have. And so I love that exercise we have of writing at least five things every day that we're grateful for. Because when you exercise gratitude, it increases that for which you are grateful. The third thing she recommends is that we live our life creatively and with enthusiasm. And the fourth thing is that we contribute something of value to the lives of others and to society. That we contribute something of value to the lives of others and to society. And finally, we need to continue to evolve spiritually. And for me, evolving spiritually means developing and maintaining with diligence a daily spiritual practice, which involves meditation, prayer, reading, just time within yourself to be, so that you can be a human being and not a human doing all the time. We're very good at doing, aren't we? We hit the ground running when we get out of the bed, and there are 552,000 things to do. And then one day, life says to you, stop. And you say, I don't know why I'm so exhausted. Well, you're so exhausted because you haven't paced yourself and you haven't given yourself the gift of a little downtime to be with you. You're afraid for yourself. A lot of us are frightened of being by ourselves, you know. And when we're alone, we have to have on the radio or the TV. There's always has to be something happening because we're frightened of the silence. So I want you to practice just being with yourself. You're so wonderful. Just be with who you are in the moment, and you will wonder, wow, why haven't I been doing this all my life? Some kind of daily spiritual practice which focuses on your own spiritual evolution. Friends, to get the job of life, you are not required to attend any hand-wringing interviews or to provide any references. You got the job because it's a family-owned business and you are related to the CEO, the Infinite. So when my youth friends say, you have to know somebody, I say, yes, the somebody you have to know is the God presence within you. You're related to the owner of the universe. So therefore, anything you want is yours because God are your papa. God is your father, for those listening on the net. And hear this. Because you are on Spirit's eternal payroll, your earning power is unlimited, and every single day is payday. And just listen to your job benefits. They include family and friends that adore you, creative self-expression, a breathtakingly beautiful work environment, comfortable housing, radiant good health, and daily spiritual insights. Your paycheck is just one channel of your infinite, inexhaustible income because it's coming from the stream, the paymaster, the person who is in the essence and the energy that is in charge of the entire universe. Have you ever wondered then why it is that some people seem to receive a better salary in life than others? They seem to live better, have more, they're happier. And you ask yourself, do they appear to be richer and happier and more personally fulfilled? Why? What they're doing, what are they doing that I'm not doing, you ask? The answer is simple. They remember to pick up their paychecks. They remember to come to the cosmic bank every day into which they have deposited love and laughter and joy and service to others and an appreciation of life, and they pick up their check. You see, their checks are good. They can draw a check on that universal bank anytime because they have made regular daily lodgments in their spiritual daily prayer work. So my question for you this morning, my friends, is have you picked up your paycheck? Today is payday, And if I may continue with the same metaphor, please remember that the senior management has an open door policy. So at any time of night or day, you have direct access to divine wisdom, intelligence, and love. Make a point of meeting regularly with senior management through prayer and meditation. And when you do, you will find that you solve problems more easily, you make wiser decisions, and you feel better about yourself and about your life. Dr. Joan Borisenko, the renowned pioneer in mind-body medicine and an unabashed mystic, says that people who work for God embody generosity of spirit. She writes in her book, Seven Paths to God, and I quote, "True generosity of spirit is a hallmark of good managers, teachers, scientists, therapists, mentors, parents, and friends. The highest intention of those who are generous in spirit is to encourage the creative potential in themselves and others, because they know that they are about God's work. They trust that whatever is needed will be provided. Abundance becomes manifest when one's intention is generous, and that when that is so, doors open unexpectedly, strangers come to our aid, and surprise money arrives in time to pay unusual bills or fund important projects." Unquote. According to Borisenko, four things are required to develop generosity of spirit. First of all is the intention to serve God in all our affairs. We have to intend that everything we do is actually in service to God. Secondly, is the belief that if the intention is honored, the universe will provide all that is required materially and spiritually for your success. Once your intention is set that you are doing this to the honor and glory of God, whatever it is, washing the dishes, making a meal, creating something, going to work, whatever it is, if you do it as unto God, the universe provides you with all that is necessary for your success. Thirdly, the understanding that we receive as we give. We know that. And that our own creativity is enhanced through mentoring others. George. So God bless you, because that's what you're doing. In mentoring others, you are serving God. You are doing something that only you can do in your own unique way. And the fourth thing is practical groundedness. God can't deliver the lottery jackpot unless we buy a ticket. We won't have a best-selling book unless we write one. Our own Doug O'Rain just proved that with the publication of his first book, The Business of Nation Building, which is available here in our book room. By the way, Doug will be the guest on Ian Boyne's show Profile on Television Jamaica this evening at 6:30 p.m. And there is a repeat of the show tomorrow morning at 9:30. In this segment, Doug explores the source of his spirituality and speaks about the impact of our teaching on his life and his work. So that's really something worth listening to. And so I encourage you, if you are at Powerful Men and Women this evening, listen to it tomorrow morning at 9:30, but try and take in the segment of Profile. It's on Television Jamaica here in Jamaica. Let us affirm, God is the center and circumference of all my affairs. Together? God is the center and circumference of all my affairs. I am abundantly supplied from the infinite universal storehouse. I am abundantly supplied from the infinite universal storehouse. In the sixth chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, the beautiful Jesus gives a wonderful teaching on abundance. Quote, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume, and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." And the question is, what do you treasure? It's just like asking, what is your passion? What is important to you, my friends? Because that is where you are putting your energy, your heart. If you are simply interested in amassing wealth and manifesting hummers, you may be able to do it, but to what end? Those are temporary, fleeting pleasures, and according to some polls, material wealth may not be such a pleasure, since it has been found that the very wealthy have a much higher suicide rate than the rest of us. I don't believe that. No truth in that. But it's making the point that having material wealth is not all there is to the business of living. And don't misunderstand me, nothing is wrong with having lots of money. I wish more and more. As long as we have it and it doesn't have us. So lay up treasures in heaven when we have a strong sense of self-worth that allows us to grow with the flow, seizing opportunities that are presented to us to serve God and to honor our fellow human beings. It is a universal law that we receive as we give. Dr. Janet Quinn, an expert in therapeutic touch, called TT for short, explains that in this simple methodology of healing, the giver of TT centers him or herself in God with an intention to be a channel for divine energy. And you don't have to be a therapeutic touch practitioner to just set your intention every day to be a channel for divine energy. Can you imagine if you opened your eyes every morning and you just said, show me what I can bring to life today? And that has a double meaning for me. Because if you bring something to life, it means that you may have resurrected it from dormancy. And also, to bring something to life is to give a gift to life. What can I give to life? What can I bring to life? What can I resurrect? What can I give joy to today? And you start your day on that kind of premise. A business produces material goods and services of one kind or another. In the spiritual business in which you have always been employed, but which you don't always show up to work for on a scholar day, the products of your spiritual life are your thoughts, words, feelings, actions, and attitudes. That's what you bring to the business of life. So you see, you're always producing something. And it would be in your best interest, if you want to have a fulfilling life, to do some quality control on what you are producing and make sure that you produce only life-enhancing products such as love, joy, light, laughter, compassion, peace of mind for yourself and for the people in your world. I see our spiritual community here at the Temple of Light Center for Spiritual Living as the production department of God's vast cosmic organization for which all humanity works. I see myself as the CCO, the Chief Consciousness Officer, and I see each of you as a valuable worker for truth without whom the cosmic staff complement would be incomplete. Our mission is to transform lives, not just by telling others about the truth, but by showing up for work every day and by living in principle. Which brings me to your assignment. You thought you would get away with no assignment this week? Not a chance. I want you to write, as your assignment this week, I want you to write, should you decide to undertake this, a job application. Dear universe, today I am applying for the job of, and fill in what your passion is, or fill in what you would like to bring to life. And say, I'm eminently employable because I have the following qualities. And list four or five qualities that you have on that job application. And just sign it, yours sincerely, yours in truth, always, and sign your name to it. Write a job application to the universe today and see how it makes you feel, and then put it up on the fridge or somewhere in the home on your dresser where you can see it every day so it reminds you that you have applied for a job that nobody else can fill. And you've applied for it by going within and speaking to the chief executive officer who is supplying all of your needs. My friends, as you apply within this week, remember that you don't have to commute to the job of being your highest and best self, the job of personalizing and individualizing spirit. There is no traffic to contend with, no traffic lights, no honking horns or route taxis suddenly swinging out in front of you. For this job, you need only close your eyes, take a couple of deep cleansing breaths, and go within where the power of spirit will energize you, the presence of spirit will strengthen you, and the intelligence and wisdom of spirit will guide you unerringly. We're talking about long-term employment here, my friends, and you have seniority. No one can ever replace you. You are vital to the mission. The universe needs you because it is unfolding through you and needs you in order to know the part of itself known as you. It will therefore support your growth as you in turn will enhance it in unimaginably beautiful ways. The truth is that as a part of creation, you are infinitely valuable. Let's say that. As God's creation, I am infinitely valuable. As God's creation, I am infinitely valuable. I play a vital role in the universe. I play a vital role in the universe. To your neighbor, say, the universe needs you. You have got the job. Congratulations. The universe needs you. You have got the job. Congratulations. The universe needs you, maestro. You have got the job. Congratulations. Friends, the universe needs you. You have got the job. Congratulations. Namaste.